Good morning, and welcome to Conversations in Christ. We invite you to sit back, open your Bible, and engage in a dialogue as we learn together more about the incredible gift of grace that God has given all of us. Now, let's reason together in love.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, Carl, Bill, and especially our guest for the third week is Don Keathley. I am so honored and privileged and excited.
Yeah, welcome,
I mean,
man.
We are really excited, especially because this organic movement I consider you're a visionary, and you have this amazing humble gift of bringing people together in such a united way. And you've shared with us about what the GAN network is, Grace Awakening Network, and it's just beautiful. And I don't know, I've read, you've got seven books. Don Keathley has seven books. This is you can't really see it here, but it's Galatians on unlocking the power of Paul's hyper grace message. And I love how we're not locked into religion, but a relationship and the spirit-driven life. You really go into that. We're free to live a spirit-driven life. Yeah. So I'd like you to just share whatever's on your heart today, Don.
Last week we were talking about, I think both of the sessions, we've talked a lot about grace, the power of grace, the necessity of grace. And one of the things I think that has separated the grace message from religion, when I look back, I think that we put a lot of emphasis on people. I sure did as a pastor, that they had to believe. Believe was a big word. You have to. I'd get you to raise your hand at the end of the service. I'd pray the prayer. You repeat it back to me, and part of it was, I believe. Well, I've come to realize with grace that believing is an effortless response to revelation.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yes,
and
it is.
Really,
yeah.
You really can't believe until you see. And so a lot of the people that I led into prayer in my pastoral days when I was preaching a mixed message, they would say they believed, but they really didn't believe because they hadn't seen anything.
Enough.
And what the result is, I would lead, you know, on a good Sunday morning, I may lead 25 people in a prayer, and then 6 months later, I don't know where they were. Mm-hmm. And it's because they really didn't have a revelation. And they said they believed because they were afraid of the consequences I told them was coming to them if they didn't believe.
Mm-hmm. It was so fear instead of love.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Somebody was saying.
Oh, I was just saying it's fear oriented, guilt oriented, instead of love and mercy and grace from God. I mean, it's just gets flipped around, opposite.
So now I go more of a thing like, you know, you're better to crock pot something, just let it cook slow, mm-hmm. until you see it for yourself, and then you can believe. Yeah. And that, I believe that's one of the benefits of this message, is because you're not forced into saying or doing something that really is not you. And we forced a lot of people into that mold of confessing and believing and trusting when they really didn't, because they were afraid of the consequences. So it was a very subtle way of manipulating and controlling people, and to get them to do what you wanted them to do. Then as soon as they said they believed, I'd get them into a discipleship class, a new members class, and get them through that, where I made them a Xerox copy of what I believed.
Yeah.
You know, would drive it into them that anything other than this was not the word of God, and anything other than this would be heresy and wrong, and you don't want to go down a wrong path. But then again, not only was the believing not them, but the theology and the beliefs I gave them were not theirs either. It was mine that was impressed on them. So what we developed was a whole group of hypocrites.
Yeah.
That would say one thing at church and live another way because it wasn't really them. So the beauty of grace is, look, you can be who you are. We take you, warts, freckles, pimples, we take you just like you are, and there's no pressure. The power of this message is there's no pressure, there's no manipulation, no fear, there's no control. And what that does is it makes the love that people develop for the Father grow exponentially. They begin to understand how much He loves them. And again, this is grace is different than religion. In religion, I told people all the time, you got to love God with all your heart. You better love God. But in grace, we reverse it and we say, look, you need to relax and let God love you.
That's right.
Just spend your time letting God love you. And out of that love that He has for you, it's a natural process of you loving Him. Didn't John say we love Him because He first loved us?
That's right.
And so in my religious days, we would try to get people to love God and think that God would then in turn love them.
That's right.
And if you don't feel the love of God, it's because you're not loving Him enough, you're not committed enough, you don't have enough faith, and God's not seeing that in you, so you're not sensing His love. What if we had just turned it around and told people, look, just relax, let God love on you, don't try to be anything that you're not, you don't have to believe anything specific right now, just let Him love you.
Yeah, I tell people, you know, on that, we need to love God with our whole heart, mind, and soul. Well, we can't do that until we understand that God loves us with yes. His whole heart, mind, and soul. Yeah. That's what changes, you know, your whole outlook on you know, this idea of loving other people, because you're motivated from Him. And it's not a command. It's not something that you have to concoct. It's just going to be something that's just going to instinctively flow out of your life.
You know, that's a verse I really used to hammer people with. You need to love God with your whole heart, mind, soul, body, strength. That's how you, and if you're not, well, just a little bit more, and you will love. Are you really sure you love Him that completely? Are you really sure this morning that you love God, spirit, soul, and body? Are you really sold out, or there's some areas of your life that you really don't love Him in? And that creates all kinds of insecurity and fear in people. And like you said, that's religious rubbish that we need to change. And it's changing. People are not buying that anymore. They're walking.
This is the weakness in turning belief into a requirement instead of a response. The question is, how much do you have to believe? What do you have to believe? To what degree? What if you quit believing? What if you're retarded? What if you're born as a crack baby? Do you have to believe, like James says, where it produces works and not just like the demons that do an intellectual ascent? That makes people very insecure, because now it all depends on them instead of on the God who saves.
Well, also, it didn't leave any room for questions. I find people that got a lot of questions, they want the questions answered before they believe, but you didn't allow questions. You just call, what do we call it? Blind faith.
Yeah.
You just have to accept it just like it is, and you got to believe it and have faith for it. So I think we turned believing into a work is what we did rather than a response.
Yep. Good point.
Yeah.
I started asking questions at church, and they gave answers, but you had to accept their answers, and you couldn't keep asking questions or – you know, really good questions. I still got good questions, and people that I talk to have really good questions. Sometimes the answers I don't know, and I just trust God, you know. But we have to have all the ducks lined up and everything's all set, and then you got to buy into this doctrinal statement and the rigged. It's kind of a rigged thing that is not allowed to be tested and checked and questioned. Questioning's good. God wants you to question Him. He says, go ahead, question me. Let's have a question and Q&A session and let it go on for years and years and years, and you'll grow and learn instead of just being stuck in something.
Yeah, we had our security in what we believed in gathering with other people. I call it confirmational biasness. The more we could come together and hear the same thing. We hear the same thing every week impressed on us. After a while, it's, you know, you believe a lie if you hear it enough and everybody around you believes it's a truth.
It's a bubble.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, if you tell somebody the same thing over and over and over and over and nothing else, they'll believe it. Because they don't have a choice. That's what indoctrination is instead of education, where you say, we're going to bring everything into the picture and let you. It's hard. It takes more time and effort and everything, but there's success in it, and there's confidence that comes out of looking at everything. Like Paul said, examine everything carefully.
Don, do you? Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was changing the subject to slightly.
Change it.
Oh no, I was just thinking about people are disillusioned with. I mean, the religion. The brands, the denominations, I think are another institution. And I think people, you know, all over are getting disillusioned with a lot of the institutions in the world.
Yeah.
And they're, you know, and it's very unsteadying. And that's why this message is even more important, how to navigate your life in this disillusioned world we're living in. We're not of this world.
It meets a need that's not being addressed, that everyone feels.
But I mean, I'm going back to what we're you're offering.
When it comes to the organized religion and the institutional church, yeah. I'll tell you my story. And what gets created out of this is these false set of goals that gets set in place, because you need to keep your job no matter what. And I remember at the end of the year, you know, the job review would come up, and it would always come down to how many baptisms did you have? How many marriages? How many Bible studies did you start? How many people accepted Christ? And there was this whole list, and I would have to sit with a senior pastor and three elders, and we would have to go through all these numbers, how much money came in. And what people don't realize, when you're in the institutional church, there people are getting counted. And I remember one of the things was as far as the church growth movement, it's so people would say, as far as accountability, so how many sheep are you running? I don't know if you remember that, but that became the buzzword for, so how many people are coming to your church? And so when people are coming to church, they have no idea how much has been put on the pastor to perform,
yeah.
and to create numbers, yeah. and to create obligations, and to reproduce themselves into other people, because they don't want to lose anybody.
I always try to be careful that I separate people from the system.
Yeah, good point.
Because I'm real hard on the system, because I'm a product of the system.
Yeah.
From the time I was born till the time I was almost 50, I was part of the system, and you become very ingrained in a system. So I try to let people identify with the system. You say, well, I'm a Baptist, I'm a Catholic, I'm a Lutheran, I'm a, you know, Don and I, Nazarenes, mm-hmm. and that immediately identifies you. So when you attack the system, you're actually, people feel like you're attacking them. They because they can't separate themselves from the system, and the system's crumbling.
Yes,
it's going down, and we got to be able to pull the people out of the system without destroying them. And
right.
That's why I think the message right now of identity is extremely important. Where's your identity? Is it what people have told you are, your family, your church, your school teachers, or is your identity in what Christ says about you?
Right.
I think this message of identity is going to become increasingly important as we wean people out of a system and onto Christ, because they've seen the two is the one. They've seen the church as serving Christ. And it's different. So I'm real hard on the system, but I try to be loving and tender to the people, mm-hmm. even though they identify and relate to the system.
Yeah, and that includes leaders too. I know a lot of pastors, and they're delightful people. They love God. They love people. They're trying to keep their church going. They're trying to provide a place for people to meet and accomplish things and help the community. There's so much good in it. But we all kind of get caught in the institutionalized aspect of it, in the trappings of it, and we trap ourselves, and then we we get treated a certain way, and we get influenced by Pastor Bob, and then we go to seminary because I want to be like Pastor Bob, and then you find out, oh, Pastor Bob didn't have it made. Pastor Bob had a lot of troubles because I can see through this now. But then you pass it on to the next idealistic person who moves into that, and then you get in ministry where you're kind of stuck because that's what your resume is and your income's in it. And now you can't be objective and do what Paul says and examine everything carefully because the dam might break, you know. Okay. So men and women get trapped in ministry sometimes. And even though they're good-hearted, they love God, they love people. I've talked to some of them who just go, I'm kind of stuck, you know. I don't know what to do about it. A lot of them actually believe more grace than they're willing to say.
Yes.
Because their churches are requiring them to protect a doctrinal statement that says this, even though they inside know it might not be like that. But they're kind of a hireling to some degree. You're hired to do that job, and if you don't do it right, you're out. I mean, there are men who, if they said what they really believe and think is at least possible, they'd be out and they'd be looking for somebody else. So it's kind of a trap a little bit.
It absolutely is. I can't tell you how I have contact with pastors now that say, I believe what you say. I believe what you're teaching about no eternal conscious torment, no Adamic nature, the Bible's not. But if I teach that, I'm going to lose my church.
I know several.
Which to me comes back to a very fundamental issue that the leader of the church really doesn't have a trust in Christ. He doesn't know his identity. He doesn't know who he is, and he doesn't know that God will take care of him and protect him. And I face that. I mean, the church I retired from, I started it almost 40 years earlier, and when I started getting this message, I knew I was probably going to face some things, and there were times I took like one step forward, and then all my staff would get around and say, Pastor, you can't, this, you're teaching wrong. That's not right. And the elders would tell me, no, I don't think, and I'd take two steps back, and then I'd get confident and take another step forward. So it is a strong manipulation and control, but there comes a day that you step over the line.
That's right.
And you say, whatever happens, happens. And that's the day that you really have grown and matured in this message of grace, is when your absolute trust is in the Father's care and protection. And I didn't know at that point everything that he had in store for me after I was outside the brick and mortar building. I just knew, he said, you need to get online. You just need to do a YouTube on Sunday morning. And so I did that, and I got out. But if that would have happened 10 or 15 years prior to that, I'd have had a real struggle.
Yeah.
Because I was identified as the pastor of the church that I started, and I was part of the system.
Yeah, and it's good to be sympathetic toward that, because when it happened to me, I was a layman in the church, and so my job didn't depend on it, and it was still hard, just emotionally and psychologically and friendship-wise, and I was seen different, and people, you know, I went through all that, but my income didn't depend. If I had to add my income, my history, my resume, all tied into this, I can see where that could be a really, really tough decision to make. It's easy to say trust Christ, but when the wolves come to the door and your income goes away, that's really a challenge. So I just try to be very understanding, sympathetic, and realize that it's a real difficult thing when people get trapped in religion, whether they're lay people or ministers or whatever. Religion's really dangerous stuff.
With lay people, it's their friends, who they think are their friends. And if I leave church, I'm leaving all my friends I've had for 20, 30 years. Our kids know each other. They've grown up together. But what they're going to find is that most of those people they thought were their friends were not their friends.
That's right.
And they just gathered with them on Sunday around a like theology and a like belief. And we were friends as long as we believed the same. But even as soon as family. We believe the same, we weren't friends anymore.
Yeah, even family, that can happen with family. And you're going, hey, I'm just trying to be honest here. But they feel betrayed because you're not in that carefully constructed narrative that they hold to, and they're hurt by it. And so
their friends,
the solution to be just love them unconditionally, just keep on loving them and loving them and loving them. And that love in the midst of, they know you're going through a struggle. And when you respond in love, it's very powerful.
I was going to say, they're friends based on performance.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then you find out it's performance love. It's not God's love.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting too. We talked about the gospel being good news. And for us, we know that it's all good news. There's no bad news. And as you're sharing this with other people who don't see it the same way, they keep waiting for that big shoe to drop. So where's the bad news? And there is none. It's
where's
all good
catch?
News.
Going, where's the catch?
No, that's too good to be true. I'm sorry. I'm not going to believe that. And that's when you start to get some of that tension and some of those arguments.
Yeah.
And that's the beauty of what we're sharing is the good news is all good. There's nothing bad about it.
Yeah. Yeah. I get the bait. Where's the hook here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there isn't any.
That's the power of inclusion. There's no insiders, outsiders.
That's
we have it. They don't have it. And that breaks down a lot of walls. And if that would infiltrate through the church, then when we don't believe the same, we still accept one another.
Yeah.
Because we're not fellowshipping and friends based on what we believe. Because no matter what you believe, you're included.
Yeah, that's right.
And you're just in a different place in the journey than I am. And that to me is a big pressure release, is when I can look at somebody, and I know they don't believe what I believe, but I can look at them and just know they're not at the same place maybe I am, but they're going to get there. But I don't have to separate myself from them. I don't have to call them a heretic. I don't have to belittle them. I can still embrace them and love them and break bread with them, be friends, and even though our beliefs are different.
And maybe in some aspects, we're going to come around to them.
Absolutely.
Sometimes, if I didn't learn any other lesson, I learned I can be wrong.
Yes.
I was bigger than I ever imagined. I never imagined that, you know, after going to seminary and being a five-point Calvinist and having all my ducks lined up, that I could possibly be wrong because I had it all figured out. Then when I found out I didn't, I go, whoa, this is humbling. And so I'm always cautious about, you know what, God, if I'm wrong in some way, show me, no matter what it is.
Did you ever know very many happy Calvinists, Carl?
Not really, but man, you feel empowered. You feel like you got an Uzi. You can go mow them down, you know, and everyone else has a switchblade knife. But actually I think it's the power of drama and trauma and that kind of stuff, where you've got this hell and damnation stuff that's, you attach it to God. It just becomes this huge, dramatic, traumatic message that you impose on yourself, then you impose it on others, and it's fear-based, it's guilt-based, it has its own power, and then you but it's all about you really bringing it over people, and then once you and you kind of condescend people. I'm in the in crowd and you're not, and you're going to hell, ha ha ha, and you know, he in the heavens laughs and all that stuff, and then you go, wait a minute, everybody's in the same boat. We're all sinners before God, and he saved everyone. That was his goal. We're all equal now by grace. It puts us on the same level field. So my disposition toward people dramatically changed.
That's what this message does. The deeper you go in unconditional love and grace, the more you demonstrate it to other people.
Yeah, you do. You'll become like the God you believe in. If you believe in a God who... You do. I mean, if you think he's mean, and look at Bloody Mary. She believed God was going to burn people in hell, so she might as well get started now and burn them at the stake if they're heretics, right? That's what she believed. But if you believe in unconditional love, I'm here to love you unconditionally. I don't care what your lifestyle is. Doesn't mean I agree with you. Doesn't mean I want to join it. But I love you without condition because I know that's how God loves me. And that changes everything.
Well, if you'd ask a good Calvinist or Arminian, do you do you love unconditionally? They would all say, yes, we believe in unconditional love. We love everybody, but it doesn't, when the rubber meets the road, that's not really the case. Donna, I wanted to ask you, you do family counseling. How much in family counseling does religion play a part in family counseling or problems that people have? Does religion play a part in a lot of families that you encounter?
Well, to some degree, there's always, I always have, if they choose to state what their background was, it gives me an idea of their thought process.
Okay.
You know, and so wherever they're coming from, I keep that in mind and I honor that in the counseling. I couldn't give a percent because I don't limit myself. I'm not a Christian counselor. I don't want to limit. I see everybody, every race, color, religion. I see every religion you can think of, or even atheists. So spiritual, if there's a threat of spirituality, which I know everyone has, then I know that there is that spirit within them. And it's so, I don't know, it's so comfortable and easy for me to tap into that.
That's good.
God, you know, God through me taps into that, but I'm very aware of that and try.
You're a true grace counselor. That's awesome.
Yeah, I have been all along. Yeah.
Great. Well, listen, we got to go because we only got about 45 seconds left.
Thank you, Don.
Don, thank you for coming on. You helped us kick off our debut on the GAN. The GAN Network, Grace Awakening Network. We're on 8:30 on Sunday mornings, Conversations in Christ, and also 8:30 Thursday nights. That's Pacific Coast time in the United States. And we'll be back next week with a new guest. And our website is conversationsinchrist.net. So get on. You can see all the shows with Don. Get information. We'd love to hear from you. If you want to give us feedback and let us know what you think, we would love to hear it. So God bless you. Thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next week. And take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you for listening to Conversations in Christ. Our prayer is that today's program has opened your heart and mind to a greater understanding and curiosity about the gift of grace that God has given to each of us in and through His Son, Jesus Christ. Remember, you have been blessed with every spiritual blessing by God, so that you may believe and begin to experience the very life of God in you. Tune in again next week for Conversations in Christ.
If you have a comment or a question, we would love to hear from you. You can contact us at conversationsinchrist.net. That's conversationsinchrist.net.